بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم وعنده مفاتح الغيب لا يعلمها إلا هو ويعلم ما في البر والبحر وما تسقط من ورقة إلا يعلمها ولا حبة في ظلمات الأرض ولا رطب ولا يابس إلا في كتاب مبين إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وأصحاب سيدنا ومولانا محمد معدن الجود والكرم منبع العلم والحلم والحكم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبارك وسلم ثم أما بعد الحمد لله We gather and sit once again to drink from the pure fountains of the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam through the book Riyadh al-Saliheen min kalami Sayyid al-Mursaleen compilation by Imam al-Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi. We continue through the chapter of kathratu turq al-khayr, the various pathways of good. Inshallah, we'll complete this chapter today from hadith 133 onwards and start the chapter bab fil iqtisad fil ibadah, the chapter of moderation in worship. So inshallah we'll cover a few ahadith from that chapter, whatever Allah Ta'ala grants us tawfiq to do inshallah. So without further ado, we begin hadith number 133 inshallah. Bismillah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم عن أبي موسى العشري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من صلى الدرتين دخل الجنة
The hadith after this, the next one.
Okay. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا مرض العبد أو سافر كتب له مثل ما كان يعمل مقيما صحيحا رواه البخاري Abu Musa reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when a slave of Allah is ill or traveling, the same is written for him as what he would normally do if he were healthy and at home. Al-Bukhari.
Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim. In this hadith, a further indication upon the beautiful mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us when a servant is ill or when a servant travels, they will achieve the same level of thawab as if they were a resident and if they were healthy, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And so when we talk about illness, first of all, this is any illness which prevents an individual from doing that which they habitually would have done in to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, that safar, regardless of how long or short that safar is, whereby it stops a person from doing that which they normally would do to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of this will not stop an individual from attaining the reward of an individual who was present, who was not on a journey, or of an individual who was fully healthy. So the Imam writes in the commentary, يُؤْخَذُ مِنَ الْحَدِيثِ تَأْيِيدُ مَنْ ذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ أَنَّ الْأَعْذَارِ فِي تَرْكِ الْجَمَاعَةِ مُسْقِطَةٌ لِلْحَرَجِ مُحَصِّلَةٌ لِلْفَضِيلَةِ خِلَافًا لِلْمُصَنِّفِ الْأَخِيرِ So this hadith strengthens our understanding and gives us, supports the view that those reasons and those asbab due to which a jama'ah will be left, a jama'ah of salah is left, for example. This still allows a person to attain that reward which they miss out on if they had that intention behind it. So this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So an individual is able to attain the same reward as they would whilst they are on a journey or whilst they are ill, as when they were healthy and when they were able to, and when they were not on a journey. So this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We come to the next hadith, hadith number 134.
An Jabir radiyallahu anhu qala an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kullu ma'rufin sadaqa, rawahu al-Bukhari. Jabir reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, every right thing is sadaqah.
Al-Bukhari. Every good thing is sadaqah. Ma'ruf, kullu ma'ruf in sadaqah. Ay, kullu ma yuf'al min al-a'mal al-birri wal-khayri. Everything you do, which is an action of goodness, which is an action of piety, it is a sadaqah. Yani, thawabuhu ka thawabiha. Yani, its reward is like the reward of sadaqah, he is saying, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So every good action, regardless of how small it is, they have all been included by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as being a charity as well. So therefore, every good action that we do is a sadaqah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that it pays back, or it is an offering of shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of the blessings that He has granted us. Hence, Allah ta'ala has, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has, made every single good action a sadaqah as well. Hadith number 135.
عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما من مسلم يورث ورثا إلا كان ما أكل منه له صدقة وما سرق منه له صدقة وما أكل السبع منه فهو له صدقة وما أكل الطير فهو له صدقة وَلَا يَرْزَأُوهُ أَحَدٌ إِلَّا كَانَ لَهُ صَدَقًا رَوَاهُ مُسْلِمٌ. Jabir also reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no Muslim plants something without what is eaten from it being sadaqah for him. Even what is stolen from it is sadaqah for him. And no one visits it without that being sadaqah for him. In one variant of it, no Muslim plants something from which man, animals or birds eat without being sadaqah for him until the day of rising. In another variant of it, no Muslim plants a tree or sows a crop from which birds, man or beasts eat without it being sadaqah for him.
So in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us another way of attaining the pleasure of Allah by planting trees from that which will benefit Bani Adam and which will benefit the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why in another hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us, if you have in your hands a sapling ready to plant, and Yawmul Qiyamah, the Day of Judgment, comes upon you, then plant your tree, he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَلْيَغْرِسْهَا. Even if the Day of Judgment comes upon you, plant that tree, he said, sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. So planting trees is a great deal of reward in Islam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has explained its reward in this hadith. Yani, no person, he said, plants a tree except that any person eats from it. Whether that person eats from it, ala wajhi tasadduqi alayhi wal ikram aw bi tariqi al ghasbi ma lam yuaddi badala. Yani, a person eats from that tree which a person has planted. Either they eat from it as a free offering, so they take it was a sadaqah. So the person who planted it intended that the fruits of this tree will be a charity for everyone, and they eat from it for free. That will be a reward for the person who planted it. Or even if the planter did not intend for it to be a sadaqah, but they intended it's going to its crops and they will be sold to produce a profit, but somebody steals fruit or somebody steals crops from there, still the reward will go to the one who planted that, because somebody has eaten from that which they have planted. That is still a charity for them, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Even if they didn't intend, they didn't plant that as a sadaqah, they will still receive that reward if it was stolen from them, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And likewise, no animal eats from it, a bird or a creature of the earth, except that it is a charity for them, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And Imam Ibn al-Arabi al-Maliki mentions, min si'ati karamillahi an yuthiba ala ma ba'd al-haya kama yuthiba ala dhalika fil haya. From the vast mercy of Allah is that Allah Ta'ala rewards after the passing away of an individual, just like He rewards in their lifetime. وَذَلِكَ فِي سِتَّةِ. And this is in six things. Yani, the six things the Imam has gathered from the ahadith of the Messenger, where Allah will reward a person in their lifetime, just as He rewards them in their life. He will reward them after, just as He rewards them in their lifetime. Number one, sadaqa jariya, ongoing charity. Any charity, any form of charity which you give, which continues, wells and water, a madrasa, masjid, whatever it is, you give charity, it continues after you're passing away, that will be continuous reward for you. Number two, ilm yuntafa'u bihi, knowledge which is benefited from, any form of knowledge which is benefited from, leaving behind students, leaving behind books, leaving behind lectures and the like. This is all form of continuous knowledge and beneficial knowledge which is benefited from, which is a sadaqah and a sadaqah, which is a continuous form of reward for the ulama. Oh, waladun salihun yad'u lah, or leaving behind pious children who will pray for you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this is also a continuous form of reward for a person in their grave. Pious children you leave behind who pray for you. Oh, gharz aw zara aw ribat aw ribat, or you leave behind plants and trees and crops, plants, trees or crops, leaving those behind. This reward will continue for a person in their grave, just as it was established for them in their lifetime. Why? Trees continue to provide fruit and to provide shelter for birds and benefit for Bani Adam. That reward will continue for a person after they pass away, the Imam mentions, rahimahullah. And so these are things we should actively engage in. It is narrated from Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, radiallahu an, in Irshad al-Sari, Imam Qastallani mentions this. He was planting apricot trees, and they take a long time to give their fruit. And he was an old man at the time. So somebody asked him, oh, Abu Sa'id, you are planting these trees now. They're not going to give fruit for a long time. And you may be long gone by then. Why are you planting them now? You won't be able to eat from them. He said, no, I won't be able to eat from them. But our forefathers planted trees so we could benefit from them. If we don't plant trees today, how will our children and grandchildren, what will they benefit from tomorrow? So Sayyidina Abu Sa'id understood the importance of this sadaqah jariyah. And in today's climate, in today's day and age, where the world is suffering and the world is literally on fire, we understand the importance of planting trees more than ever before in this world that we live in today. Our world is desperately in need of more greenery and more trees. They are being cut down. And this is something the Prophet ﷺ did not command. A tree which gives fruit, Rasulullah ﷺ did not instructed that it should not be cut down, but instructed to plant them instead, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is all a continuous reward. And the last and final thing, al-ribat, yani a person, providing some safety and security to the Muslims, and that continues after they pass away. This is an ongoing charity as well. Okay then, so these people will receive reward in their lifetime, and they will continue to receive that reward after they have passed away as well. وَلَا يَخْتَصُّ حُصُولُ هَذِهِ الصَّدَقَاتِ بِمَنْ بَاشَرَ الْغَرْسَ أَوِ الزَّرَاعَ بَلْ يَتَنَاوَلْ مَنْ اسْتَأْجَرَ لِعَمَلِ ذَلِكَ. The Imam says that it's not just the person who plants the crops or trees who gets the reward. It's not just the person who plants the trees who gets the reward, but يَتَنَاوَلْ مَنْ اسْتَأْجَرَ لِعَمَلِ ذَلِكَ. If somebody employed another person so that that person could plant trees on their behalf, i.e. they facilitated for trees and crops and fruit to be planted, then they will get the reward in that sense as well. Yani it's not necessary that you yourself plant the tree to attain that sadaqah and the continuous reward after you pass away. But if you facilitated for that to take place, maybe in another country, or you asked somebody to do it on your behalf, that would still come into your account as your reward after you pass away. وَالصَّدَقَ حَاصِلَةٌ حَتَّى فِي مَا عَجِزَ أَنْ جَمْعِهِ كَالصُّنْبُلِ الْمَعْجُوزَ عَنْهُ بِالْحَصَدِ فَيَأْكُلُ مِنْهُ حَيَوَانٌ فَإِنَّهُ مُنْدَرِجٌ تَحْتَ مَدْلُولِ الْحَدِيثِ. Those things which are cannot be accessed in their pure form, but they have to be cultivated, and then they have to be made into something, and then they could be provided to animals. For that a person will receive sadaqah. So you plant something which animals can't eat from directly, but it will be made into something which animals can eat from or people can benefit from. All of this is a form of continuous charity for us. So planting trees, planting crops, These are all wonderful forms of continuous reward even after we pass away, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us. And alhamdulillah, most of us have gardens. If we don't have gardens, get an allotment and do it with this, with the intention of fulfilling this command of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Plant something. If you can't plant it yourself, facilitate for it to be planted elsewhere. And this will be a continuous, ongoing reward for you. Trees last a long time. And every time that tree provides shade for somebody, or it provides shelter for any of the creatures of Allah, or its fruit provides food for any person or for any bird, all of that is an ongoing charity for a person. So we should. This is a beautiful way of earning continuous reward in our graves, planting trees. And so this is the advancement of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his thinking and how to cultivate and maintain a healthy and environmentally friendly society. He was instructing the planting of trees 1,400 years ago in the middle of the desert. He was instructing people to plant trees in their lands. And this is sublime and incredible thinking from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. We come to the next hadith, hadith number 136.
أنه قال أراد بن سلمة أن ينتقلوا قرب المسجد فبلغ ذلك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال لهم إنه قد بلغني أنكم تريدون أن تنتقلوا قرب المسجد فقالوا نعم يا رسول الله قد أردنا ذلك فقال بني سلمة دياركم تكتب أثاركم رواه مسلم. وفي رواية إن بكل خطوة درجة وروى البخاري أيضا معناه من رواية أنس رضي الله عنه.
الله أكبر.
Jabir رضي الله عنه said that Banu Salma wanted to move near to the mosque and the messenger of Allah. May Allah bless him and grant him peace. He heard about it. He said to them, "It has reached me that you want to move near to the mosque." They said, "Yes, messenger of Allah, we do want that." He said, Banu Salma, keep the houses you have, your footprints are written down. Muslim narrated it. In that one variant, there is a degree for each footstep.
Allahu Akbar. So this hadith shows us some very beautiful things. First of all, the passion of the Banu Salama radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, was a tribe in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their passion for attending the masjid, for being in the first saff of salah, for being on time for every prayer. This was their passion, that they wanted to buy a property or buy some area of land so they could live close to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many of us, when we are looking where to live, there are factors which determine where we buy our properties and where we buy our houses and where we live. And very often those factors are not determined on how close it is to the masjid, or where the masjid is. Those factors are often determined on other things, worldly things, which in reality bring us little benefit. We look at other factors. But this is the thinking of the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. They wanted to be close to the masjid to attain the reward of the first saf. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the reward of the first saf is such that if you knew, you would fight one another to attain that reward. He says, and we still have to convince people to move to the first saf on the day of Jummah. Everybody likes coming and leaning against the walls. Have to convince people, please move forward. And even then, some people don't want to listen. Allahu Akbar. Just giving up free reward. So this is the passion of the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, wanting to attain the reward of being in the first saf for the salah, wanting to attain the reward of constantly being in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Masjid Nabawi, wanting to constantly be able to enter the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Rasulullah, let us move close to you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave them advice and told them to stay where they were. Why? Because he knew they loved the masjid, whether they close or far, they'll still come. Even if they move away, they'll still come because they love the house of Allah. So the Prophet ﷺ told them, "Stay, diyarakum tuktab atharukum. Stay where you are. O Banu Salama, your footsteps will be written as reward for you." Allahu Akbar. So this is the reality of the matter. Even if a person lives distant from the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, consider the reward you get for every footstep that you take towards the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and allow that to be your motivation in attaining reward. And if we can make long journeys for meals out, then making a journey 10 minutes to the masjid and 10 minutes back is no difficult task. And we must ask ourselves where our priorities are, every single one of us. So this is the reality of the matter. The Prophet ﷺ told them, stay where you are. وَإِنَّ بِكُلِّ خَطْوَةٍ دَرَجَةً. Every footstep you take, your rank will be increased, he said. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Your rank will be increased. May Allah Ta'ala give us the same zeal and passion as these great Sahaba in pleasing our Lord. Hadith 137.
عن أبي المنذر أبي بن كعب رضي الله عنه قال كان رجل لا أعلم رجلا أبعد من المسجد منه وكان لا تخطئه صلاة فقيل له فقلت له لو اشتريت حمارا تركبه في الظلماء وفي الرمضاء فقال ما يسرني أن منزلي إلى جنب المسجد إني أريد أن يكتب لي ممشاي إلى المسجد ورجوعي إذا رجعت إلى أهلي فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قد جمع الله لك ذلك كله رواه مسلم
الله أكبر
وفي رواية إن لك ما احتسبت الرمضاء الأرض التي أصابها الحرب الشديد Abu al-Mundir Ubay ibn Ka'ab said, there was a man, and I do not know of any man who lived further from the mosque than him. He never missed a prayer. It was said to him, or I said to him, you should buy a donkey which you could ride in the dark and when it is very hot. He said, it would not make me happier if my house were right next to the mosque. I want my steps to the mosque to be written down for me and also my return when I return to my family. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah will combine all that for you. In one variant, you will have what you reckoned.
Allahu Akbar. Very beautiful hadith. Okay, we begin with the narrator of the hadith, Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'ab radiyallahu ta'ala an. So Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'ab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he is a companion. We haven't discussed his biography before, so we go through his biography briefly. He took part in the pledge of Aqaba. The second pledge of Aqaba, yani Bay'atul Aqaba al-Thaniyah. He took part in the second pledge of Aqaba before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Medina alongside 70 companions from the Ansar, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. He took part in the Battle of Badr and all of the rest of the battles with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, narrated 164 ahadith from the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasallam. And he has numerous virtues. Amongst his virtues, Sayyidina Ubay, is that he is amongst the Qurra of the Sahaba. He is amongst the reciters, expert reciters and expert memorizers of the Qur'an from amongst the companions. And it is narrated about him that Sayyidina, and this is one fadila that he has that no other companion matches him in. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam recited Surah Lam Yakunil Ladhina Kafaru, Surah Bayyina, to Ubay ibn Ka'b, yani Rasulullah recited it to Ubay ibn Ka'b. فقال أمرني الله عز وجل أن أقرأ عليك. After reading Bayyina to Ubay ibn Ka'b, he said, Allah commanded me to read Surah Bayyina to you, O Ubay. Allahu Akbar. So this is a great virtue that he is alone in possessing, Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu. And he is the teacher. So the chain of transmission from the Qurra Saba'a, from the seven main reciters, Imam Nafi' al-Madani. Imam Nafi' al-Madani, from who you have the riwayah of Warsh and the riwayah of Qalun. These two riwayat of the Qur'an are narrated from Imam Nafi' al-Madani. And Imam Nafi' al-Madani gets his chain of transmission from Sayyiduna Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala an. So that's where we get that recitation from Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu an. So he is amongst the great companions of the Sahaba in terms of the recitation of the Qur'an. So he said, I knew a person There was nobody further away from the masjid than this individual. Yani he lived very far from the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But alongside that, la tukhti'uhu salatun. Ay, la tafutuhu. No prayer. He would never miss a prayer. No prayer would pass by him. And this is no easy task. Yani five prayers a day with jama'ah in the masjid, alongside a family, alongside work responsibilities. Yet today we complain that we're too busy, there's too many things going on. I ask the question, in the time of the Sahaba, do you think they were busier or do you think they were not busier? Okay, washing machines they didn't have, dishwashers they didn't have, tap water they didn't have. All of these amenities that we have, which make our life very accessible, cars they didn't have, right? They didn't have none of that. That means they're washing clothes by hand. They are squeezing them dry by hand. They are going to the river or the well to get buckets of water and carry it home. If it runs out, they have to go and get it again. They have to light fires, they have to chop the firewood and light fires under a stove. So are they having it easier or we got it easier? They're more busy, we more busy. Those things take time. They have to put time into doing all of that. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een. We've got all of these amenities. Despite that, this individual still found time 5 times a day to not miss a salah. This, and his house was far. These people didn't have an excuse. Where is our excuse? Why do we have excuses not to attend the masjid? So he wouldn't miss a prayer. So Sayyidina Ubay said to him, why don't you get a donkey or a donkey so you can ride it in the dark and in the night, make your journey easier for yourself. And look at his response. He said, I don't want to live close to the masjid. It's not that I want to live close to the masjid. Not that the distance doesn't bother me. The distance doesn't bother me. I just want to see my reward for walking to the masjid and walking back to my family after I've prayed the salah. That's what I'm interested in. فَقَالَ قَدْ جَمَعَ اللَّهُ لَكَ ذَٰلِكَ كُلَّهُ. Allah Ta'ala has gathered all of that reward for you, he said. صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَإِنَّ لَكَ مَحْتَسَبْتَ. You will have that which you are expectant of. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam affirmed his expectations. So we learn that when we perform any good deed, we should have ihtisab of our reward from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. Hence in the hadith of Ramadan, in Taraweeh and the fast, مَنْ قَامَ رَمَضَانَ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. مَنْ صَامَ رَمَضَانَ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. Whoever fasts whilst they have ihtisab, yani whilst they are expecting reward from Allah, so they do it with a deliberate intention, with an attitude of gaining reward from Allah, then they will be rewarded, their sins will be pardoned. Likewise, whoever performs a taraweeh ihtisab, and meaning they're expectant of reward from Allah, their past sins will be forgiven. So having ihtisab of our reward from Allah is incredibly important, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward us with that which we ask for. We come to the next hadith, hadith 138.
عن أبي محمد عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 40 خصلة أعلاها منيحة العنز ما من عامل يعمل بخصلة منها رجاء ثوابها وتصديق موعودها إلا أدخله الله بها الجنة رواه البخاري المنيحة أن يؤتيه إياها ليأكل لبنها ثم يردها إليه. Abu Abdullah ibn Amr reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "There are 40 qualities, the highest of which is giving away all an animal's milk. If anyone acts with any one of these qualities, hoping for its reward and affirming what is promised by it, on account of it, Allah will admit him to the garden." Al Bukhari narrated it.
Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So, first of all, the biography of the narrator. The narrator of this hadith is Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma, Sahabi ibn al-Sahabi. So, he is a companion, Abdullah ibn Amr. His father is Amr ibn al-As, who is also a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he accepted Islam before his father. Abdullah ibn Amr accepted Islam before his father. And he was from amongst the Sahaba, mujtahid. He was a mujtahid sahabi, kathir al-ilm. Yani he was an incredibly knowledgeable companion, especially in in the acts of ibadah and in relation to the tilawa of the Quran. And he was a very knowledgeable companion, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. وكان أكثر الناس أخذا للحديث والعلم عن رسول الله. Sayyidina Amr, Abdullah ibn Amr is amongst those companions who took most knowledge and the most ahadith from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Even Abu Huraira used to say, there is nobody, ما كان أحد أكثر حديثا عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثبت ما كان أحد أكثر حديثا عن رسول الله مني إلا عبد الله بن عمر. There's nobody who took more hadith from the Messenger of Allah than me, Abu Huraira said, except for Abdullah ibn Amr. So this is his maqam. So he narrates this hadith, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there are 40 qualities of good. Why didn't the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explain all of them? He did not explain all of them in order to create inside the Sahaba and inside of the rest of the Ummah who would hear his words, a longing and a yearning to learn what these 40 are and search out for them. Had he listed the 40 sallallahu alayhi wasallam, people would have found that 40, they would have acted by that 40, and they would have maybe not be interested in any action of good beyond the 40. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam left it mujmal, yani he left it unclarified. And he left it unclarified so that people actively try to find out and search what these 40 qualities are which earn a person paradise. So this is why he left it without mentioning them. So after mentioning there are 40, he said the best of them, the ba'alaha manihatul anzi, the best of them is what? The milk of an animal. The best of them is the gifting of the milk of an animal. That's what he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. This is the gifting of all of the milk of an animal to another person. Yani anything, in other words, anything which is beneficial, anything which is beneficial to another person which they deeply require, gifting this to another individual. This is why Imam Ibn Hajar in Fathul Bari mentions kullu dhalika hibatu manafi', hibatu manafi'. It means gifting of beneficial things. Yani out of 40 qualities which earn you paradise, one of them and the greatest of them is gifting something which will benefit, truly benefit another individual. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves this. Giving gifts is incredibly rewarded in Islam anyway. It's from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to give and accept gifts. And he said, tahabu tahabu. Give gifts to one another, you will love one another. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So giving gifts is sunnah anyway. But to give a gift which is something which is beneficial to another person, which will bring them comfort, will bring them ease in their life, this is of a greater reward. Hence the Prophet ﷺ mentioned it as being one of the 40 characteristics which will enter a person into paradise. He said, "Ma min amilin ya'malu bi khaslatin minha." Nobody does one of these 40 things, especially gifting that which is beneficial to another person, with two conditions. Number one, raja'a thawabiha. They are hopeful of its reward from Allah. Wa tasdiqa maw'udiha. And they verify that which they have been promised in response from this action from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the two conditions for any amal, any good deed that you do. Number one, you are hopeful of its reward, and number two, you affirm the promise that Allah has given you in return, which is Jannah. So have these conditions fulfilled when you perform any good deed, and when you do that, adkhalahu Allahu al-Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant a person paradise, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Okay, Sayyidina Hassan ibn Thabit radiyallahu an, he mentions in another hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, he mentions that فَعَدَدْنَا مَا دُونَ مَنِيحَةَ الْعَنْزِ مِنْ, he says that we who were listening to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talking about these 40 characteristics, we together listed 15 out of the 40. We managed to think of and arrive at 15 from those 40 which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was talking about. So what are those 15 characteristics which they mentioned? Number one, raddu salam. It was to reply to the salam. Tashmeetul aatis. It is to say yarhamuk Allah to somebody who says alhamdulillah after they sneeze. Imatatul adha anit tariq. It's to remove to remove obstacles from the pathway, to remove obstacles from the pathway. And he says, we try to list more. فَمَسْتَطَعْنَا أَنَّبْلُغَ 15 خَصْلَةً. He said, we couldn't at that moment come up with 15 out of those 40. And so the Prophet ﷺ left it ambiguous so that people can strive, just like the Sayyidina Hassan did here, strive in figuring out what those 40 characteristics are which earns a person paradise, and then perform them. And so this really demonstrates the mentality of the companions, ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. And they were told there's 40 characteristics. So they sat down, right, let's work out, what are these 40? And they start to list them actively, because they're desperate for paradise, even though they've been promised paradise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَكُلَّا وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى. Whereas us, it is the opposite. Yani, we can be told all 40 and still will be lethargic, unable to get off the sofa for the jama'ah. So this is the mentality of the Sahaba versus our mentality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that zeal and passion, inshallah. Hadith number 139.
An Ali ibn al-Hatim radiyallahu anhu qal, sami'tu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul, uttaqun nara walau bi shiqqi tamratin muttafaqun alayhi. Adi ibn Hatim said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, protect yourselves from the fire even if only with half a day.
Right, and the next part, وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ لَهُمَا
وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ لَهُمَا أَنَّا قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا سَيُكَلِّمُهُ رَبُّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ تَرْجُمَانٌ فَيَنْظُرُ أَيْمَنَ مِنْهُ فَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا مَا قَدَّمَ وَيَنْظُرُ أَشْأَمَ مِنْهُ فَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا مَا قَدَّمَ وَيَنْظُرُ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ فَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا النَّارَ تِلْقَاهَا وَجْهِهِ فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ وَلَوْ بِشِقِّ تَمْرَةٍ فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجَدْ فَبِكَلِمَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ.
الله أكبر.
In a variant in both Al-Bukhari and Muslim, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is not a single one of you who will not be spoken to directly by his Lord without any mediator in between, and he will look to his right and see only what he sent ahead, and will look to his left and see only what he has sent ahead. He will look in front of him and see only the fire facing him. Protect yourselves from the fire, even if only with a half a day. And if you cannot find even that, then with a good word.
Allahu Akbar. So this is a very, very important hadith and a very striking hadith. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has set the scene here for all of us and our standing before Allah. He said, there is no person except that Allah will talk to them, وَلَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهُ تَرْجُمَانٌ. And there will not be any translator, i.e. there will not be any intermediary between you and Allah when you stand to answer for your deeds. This is what he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There will be a moment on Yawm al-Qiyamah where we stand for our hisab. There will not be any intermediary before us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah ta'ala tells us, أَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ يَوْمٌ لَا بَيْعٌ فِيهِ وَلَا خُلَّةٌ وَلَا شَفَاعَةٌ. Spend in the way of Allah before that day comes to you where there will be no transactions taking place. You won't be able to buy your way out from difficulty on the Day of Judgment. وَلَا خُلَّةٌ. There will be no intimate friendship on the Day of Judgment. So friendship won't save you. وَلَا شَفَاعَةٌ. Neither will there be intercession on your behalf except by the permission of Allah for the Anbiya and the rest of them, as we know. But nobody will be able to intercede on your behalf when you stand for the hisab before Allah. So this is what the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us in this hadith here. That you will stand before Allah, there will be no tarjuman. There will be no intermediary at that point between you and Allah. What will you do? Every one of us should visualize this. يَنْظُرُ أَيْمَنْ مِنْهُ فَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا مَا قَدَّمْ. A person will look to their right. They will only see that day which they have sent forth. Yani, on their right side, it means the good deeds. So on the right side, when they look at the right side, they are looking towards مَا قَدَّمَ مِنْ مِنَ الْأَعْمَالِ الْحَسَنَةِ. What they have seen, what they have sent forth in terms of good deeds, they will see that on their right side. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when they look on their left side, they will see what bad deeds they have sent forward. Min a'mal min sayyi a'malihi, from that they will see their bad deeds on the left side, he said sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and in front of them they will see the fire. Allahu Akbar. All of us have this mawqif to stand in front, to stand upon. On your right side your good deeds, on your left your bad, and in front of you the fire of Jahannam, and you are standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fa ayna tadhhabun, where will we go? Allahu Akbar. May Allah Ta'ala make hisab easy for us. So this is what every single one of us will face. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told us then, فَاتَّقُ النَّارَ, you are going to face, yani he's telling you, you are going to face the fire. You will be standing in front of the fire. You will feel its heat on your face. You will stand there in front of it. You will see the darkness of the fire. You will hear the screams of pain of its inhabitants. So he said, فَاتَّقُ النَّارَ, avoid that fire which you will face on the day of judgment. Avoid it by walaw bishqi tamaratin, even if it means, even if all you can do afford to do is give half a date in charity, even if all you can afford is half a date of sadaqah, protect yourselves from the fire by giving that half a date in sadaqah. Yani Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us, even if all you can do is that small amount of sadaqah, all you can do is that small amount of good, do it and save yourselves from the fire from that, even if it's just that. And if you can't find anything to spend in the way of Allah, then a good word, kalima tayyiba, yani bi qawlin hasanin yatibu bihi qalbul muslim. Save yourself from the fire. If you can't spend in the way of Allah and give sadaqah, then save yourself from the fire of Jahannam by good words, i.e. that word, a beautiful word which will please the heart of a Muslim, he said sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Save yourself from the fire from that. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is teaching us a few things here in this hadith. Number one, the importance of these small deeds which we overlook in terms of a kind word which will please another person, or half a date in charity if it is done with sincerity, and their importance and their weight with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in saving us from the fire of Jahannam. So every single one of us should consider this then. And we know that often it is these deeds which save us from our punishment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's like Sayyidina Junaid al-Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, and Sayyidina Junaid, Allahu Akbar, in his a'mal, his ibadah, his taqwa, his zuhud, his mujahadah, in all of this cannot be matched. And what did he say? He said, somebody saw him in his dream after he passed away. And he said, all of my a'mal, they brought me no benefit. Nothing brought me any benefit except for two raka'ats of nafil, which I used to pray in the night. That's the only thing that brought me and saved me from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment. Two raka'ah of nafil I used to pray in the night. Like Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi mentioned about him, something very similar. He showed kindness to a fly. He allowed a fly to take from some water. And it was that act of kindness which saved him, which he says saved him. And we've heard the hadith previously about the prostitute who gave water to the dog, so Allah forgave her. And the man who brought the filled his leather sock with the water and gave that to a dog, so Allah saved him from the fire of Jahannam. So these small deeds are what will save us from the fire of Jahannam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us, save yourselves from the fire, even if it be by these small deeds that you perform, he said. Sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Hadith number 140.
عن أنس رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله لا يرضى عن العبد أن يأكل الأكلة فيحمده عليها أو يشرب الشربة فيحمده عليها رواه مسلم والأكلة بفتح الهمزة وهي الغدوة أو العشرة. أنس رضي الله عنه reported that the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Allah is pleased with his slave who eats a morsel and praises Allah for it, or takes a drink and praises Allah for it. Muslim.
Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased. Yani Allah ta'ala is radi with an individual who eats something and then says Alhamdulillah, or drinks something and then says Alhamdulillah. And that's the aslus sunnah, that we eat and we drink, and after we eat and drink and we say Alhamdulillah. When should we say this and at what point should we say this? The Imam mentions, Ibn Malik mentions, and other ulama, من السنة ألا يرفع صوته بالحمد عند الفراغ من الأكل إذا لم يفرغ جلساؤه كي لا يكون mana'an lahum. We should say alhamdulillah, or we should say it in a visible voice, but we should not say it until the rest of the people have finished eating at the dinner table. Why? In order not to prevent them from eating their fill. If one person says alhamdulillah very loud, maybe the other guests who wanted to eat more will not eat because somebody has finished. So we should wait until everybody else has finished and then say alhamdulillah in a audible voice. This is the sunnah, and this is the adab of saying alhamdulillah. So we say it after we have finished, and after everybody else has finished as well, we say alhamdulillah. And Allah Ta'ala is radi with the person who does that. Why? Because this is shukr to Allah. This is shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is well pleased with those ibad of his who are grateful to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, hadith 141.
عن أبي موسى رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال على كل مسلم صدقة قال أرأيت إن لم يجد قال يعمل بيده فينفع نفسه ويتصدق قال أرأيت إن لم يستطع قال يعين بالحاجة الملهوف قال أرأيت إن لم يستطع قال يأمر بالمعروف وبالخير قال أرأيت إن لم يفعل قال يمسك عن الشر فَإِنَّهَا صَدَقَةٌ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. Abu Musa reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, every Muslim should give sadaqah. He said, what about if someone has nothing to give? He said, he should get work and earn something and give sadaqah. He said, and if he is unable to do that, he said, he should help someone in need. He said, what if he cannot find anyone? He said, he should command what is right or good. He said, what if he cannot do that? He said he should refrain from evil.
Okay. So this is a beautiful hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, must sadaqah is due on them. Why? Shukran li ni'amillah allati la tu'ad wa la tuhad. As a gratitude to Allah for those blessings which are innumerable and without limit. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then they asked him, ya Rasulullah, if he has nothing to give sadaqah. Qala ya'mal bi yadayhi fa yanfa'u nafsahu wa yatasaddaq. Then if they don't have money to give sadaqah, they should work, benefit themselves, and give sadaqah. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَفِيهِ الْحَثَ عَلَىٰ اِكْتِسَابِ مَا تَدُعُ إِلَيْهِ حَاجَةُ الْإِنسَانِ. In this hadith, therefore, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us the importance of a person working to fulfill their own needs so that they can save themselves from asking other people and so that they can give sadaqah, لِيَكْتَسِبَ الثَّوَابَ الْجَزِيلِ بِالْقَصْدِ الْجَمِيلِ, so they can attain that great reward of sadaqah as well. Imam Muhammad al-Shaybani, rahimahullah, mentioned in Kitab al-Kasab, that what? A person to work to earn wealth to fulfill our own hajat, this is fard ayn upon every single individual. So every person who has requirements to fulfill in terms of themselves and their families, to work to fulfill those requirements, this is fard ayn. Fard ayn. So we must take this into consideration. The Prophet Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala, he used to say, I don't like seeing people who are farigh in deen and farigh in dunya. Yani, I don't like seeing people who they don't do any good, neither in deen, neither any good in dunya. Yani, neither are they busy studying the deen. That's why they're not working, so they can study the deen and then teach the ummah of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They're not doing that, or neither are they working to provide for themselves and the family. Just couch potatoes, just wasting time, living off social security or living off benefits of the government. This is not a person who is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for a person who works to earn their own halal living, al-kasibu habibullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the one who works to earn their living is the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah ta'ala loves that. This is why in another hadith, there was a young man who would work very hard in the fields, and some companions were saying, what? If only he used this strength of his and this youth of his in the way of Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, no, don't say that. If his intention by hard work is to follow the path of the shaitan, yani he's doing hard work so he can gain wealth, and then his intention is dunya, his intention is competition in the dunya, then he is in the path of the shaitan, he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But if he is working this hard because he's got a family to take care of, because he wants to fulfill his own needs, because he wants to earn halal rizq, then he is in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. So working to earn our living, this is beloved to Allah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, if you're not able to give sadaqah, work, benefit yourself, and then give sadaqah, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And then they said, ya Rasulullah, illam yastati'. If a person is not able, they're too elderly, or they're not able to do anything because of an illness, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yu'inu dhal hajat al-malhoof. Help an individual who is unable to fulfill their own requirements. Yani help, if you're not able to work and earn your own rizq, and earn your own requirements, and then give sadaqah of it, help an individual. How? يعني إعانة المرء أن يحمله على دابته أو يعينه على حمل متاعه عليها أو يوصل حاجة لمن لا يقدر على إيصالها من ذي سلطان. يعني you help a person, whether that be you helping a person into their transport, or you helping them with carrying their goods or putting their goods onto that transport, something small like this, or giving, fulfilling a need for a person who is able to, unable to do it for them, for themselves. All of this comes under helping an individual. Wallahu fi auni al-abd, ma dam al-abd fi auni akhi. Allah will help Allah. Allah will help His servants as long as the servants continue to be in service of their brothers. He said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They said, ya Rasulullah, if he can't do that, he can't help another person physically or financially. فَقَالَ يَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Then they should invite towards the good. They should invite towards the good, and then towards all actions of khair. He said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ya Rasulullah, if they can't do that, if they are unable to do that, then he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, yumsik ani shar. If you can't benefit a person, not with your words, not with your actions, not by giving sadaqah, then hold back your evil from other people. Hold back your evil from other people. فَإِنَّهَا صَدَقَةٌ. That is your charity, he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. If you cannot benefit, do not harm. And this is a charity from you, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. And that holding back from harming people, this the Imam mentions in the commentary, هَذَا هُوَ الشُّكْرُ الْوَاجِبُ الْكَافِي فِي شُكْرِ هَذِهِ النِّعَمِ. This holding back from harming people and harming the creation of Allah, whether by words or whether by actions, this is the bare minimum of shukr, which is wajib upon every person for the blessings Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us. This is the bare minimum which is wajib, yani to hold back from harming other people. That's the bare minimum which is wajib, to hold back from harming people. Yani we should consider this. Whenever we utter words of insult to another person, or we use our limbs to harm the makhluk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in any way, that is ingratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And doing that, part of doing that is a gratitude to Allah. So if we want motivation to stay away from talking ill of a person, you want motivation to stay away from doing good, bad towards a person, let it be the fact that you're abstaining from that is a gratitude to you, and it's a wajib gratitude to you, from you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the bare minimum. And if we can't even do that, if we can't hold back our harm from people, we have not fulfilled the wajib. We have not fulfilled the bare minimum which is necessary upon us as shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Never mind anything beyond that which is due to Him. And he is due far more than just this bare minimum. He is due far more. And he is due charity. And he is due salah. And he is due our kindness to the makhluk. And all of the other duties that we have, all of the other branches of faith which we follow, Allah Ta'ala is due all of that from us. But if we can't even fulfill the bare minimum, which is to hold back our evil from the people, then we haven't even done that which is wajib upon us in terms of shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what the Imam says. أَمَّا الشُّكْرُ الْمُسْتَحَبُ فَبِأَنْ يَزِيدَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ بِالنَّوَافِلِ الطَّاعَاتِ الْقَاسِرَةِ كَالْأَذْكَارُ وَالْمُتَعَدِّيَةِ كَالصَّدَقَةِ وَالْإِعَانَةِ. And that shukr which is mustahab is that we increase beyond this. Yani we don't just stop our harm from reaching people, but we increase beyond that by nawafil, by adhkar, by any khair which is mutaaddi, any khair which is extends to another person, like sadaqah and helping them in their actions. With that, alhamdulillah, we've completed the chapter of kathratu turq al khair, and we come to the next chapter, which is bab fil iqtisad fil ibadah, the chapter of moderation in worship. This is a very beautiful chapter, and there are very beautiful ahadith in this chapter which we'll discuss inshallah. So babun fil iqtisad fil ibadah, we read the two verses of the Quran that the imam mentions at the beginning and their translation inshallah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى وقال الله تعالى يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر سورة البقرة. Chapter on moderation in worship. Allah سبحانه وتعالى says, طه, we did not send the Quran to you to make you miserable. And the Almighty says, Allah desires ease for you. He does not desire difficulty for you. Surah
Allahu Akbar. And this is the spirit of our deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen is a deen of moderation. Hence, Allah ta'ala says to Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, we did not reveal the Quran on you, لتشقى, to sadden you, O Messenger. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the Quran was not revealed to sadden you, yani by burdening you with too much, with that which you cannot bear. It wasn't revealed to sadden us, to burden us, to create difficulty for us. The Quran was revealed as a rahmah, as a huda, as a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the revelation of the Quran. So that tells us the nature of the deen. The Quran wasn't revealed to sadden. So the deen is not there to sadden and overburden us. It is there to facilitate our sa'adah. It is there to facilitate our felicity in this dunya and the akhirah. And then hence Allah Ta'ala says, Allah desires ease for you and Allah Ta'ala does not desire difficulty for you. Okay, what is al-iqtisad? Literally, iqtisad means tawassut. It means moderation, to take the middle way. That's the meaning of iqtisad. It is tawassut in your worship to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. إِبْقَاعًا عَلَى النَّفْسِ وَدَفْعِهَا لِلْمَلَئِ عَنْهَا. Such that you can maintain. Iqtisad is to maintain a moderation in worship such that you can maintain it for a long time and such that you can dispel from yourself boredom and becoming fed up with this action or with this worship. That's the meaning of iqtisad, to choose a balanced way of doing something such that it you can easily continue it and such that you can dispel from yourself malal, you can dispel boredom from yourself. And dispel, you know, stop yourself from becoming too fed up too quickly. The Imam explains why. He says, "Nafsul insan kadabatin fi tariq al-hissi." Human beings in their nature are like what? Animals when they are traveling. Animals on a journey. He says, "Fakama annahu idha jadda ala dabbatihi al-hissiya wa kaddaha bil ahmal al-thaqila wa qat' al-masafat al-tawila in qat'at bihi fi athna al-tariq wa lam yasil ila maqsadihi." If a person is harsh on their animal, whipping the animal and makes it carry heavy loads and makes it travel long distances, forcing it to continue and continue, what will happen? In قطعت به في أثناء السفر. The animal will stop halfway. It won't continue. And he won't be able to reach his destination. وَإِذَا رَفِقَ بِهَا وَمَاشَاهَا وَصَلَ إِلَى الْمُرَادِ وَهَانَ عَلَيْهِ بِبُلُوغِهِ مَقْصَدِهِ مَا لَقِيَ مِن مَشَقَّةِ كَذَلِكَ هُنَا. But if a person is soft with the animal that they're riding, they take it gently and they take it, you know, slow and steady wins the race, then they will be able to reach their end goal. The human soul and human nature is the same. If we are harsh with our bodies and ourselves in terms of our worship, in terms of how we take our deen, and we plunge ourselves into doing that which we cannot maintain for a long time. We plunge ourselves into burden ourselves with too much at once. We will stop halfway. We will not reach our objective. But if we take it gently and slowly and we take only that which we can manage and maintain, we will reach our objective, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us. And this is the nature of our deen. This is the nature of our deen. So to take the path of moderation. Deenullahi yusrun. The deen of Allah is easy. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. So we read a hadith in this chapter. We come to the first hadith number 140.
142. Tafaddal. قال من هذه؟ قالت هذه فلانة تذكر من صلاتها. قال ما عليكم بما تطيقون؟ فوالله لا يمل الله حتى تملوا. وكان أحب الدين إليه ما دوام صاحبه عليه. متفق عليه.
Translation.
Aisha رضي الله عنها reported that once the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came when a woman was with her. He asked, who is this? She replied, so and so, and told him about the amount she prayed. He said, stop. You must only do what you are able. By Allah, Allah does not grow weary of giving rewards as you grow weary. And indeed, he likes best is the one which is there is consistency.
Okay, so Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha was visited by a woman, and it is narrated about this woman, hiya a'budu ahli al-Madina. She was amongst the most ardent of worshippers, the most dedicated of worshippers in the society of Medina, this woman. كانت لا تنام تصلي. She would not sleep, she would pray all night. This was the extent of her passion and extent of her mujahada in her worship. أَعْبُدُ أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَةِ. The most ardent of the worshippers of Medina. And Sayyidah Aisha told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the nature of her ibadah. Yani all night she would spend praying. فَقَالَ مَهْ. مَهْ in Arabic means, it means stop. إِشَارَةً إِلَى كَرَاهَةِ ذَلِكَ خَشْيَةَ الْمَلَلِ وَالْفُطُورَ عَلَى فَائِلِهِ. And the reason why he told her to stop from worshipping all night is because he feared that what? She would become fed up. And it would become too much for her. And then she would leave. فَيَنْقَطِ عَنِ الْإِبَادَةِ الَّتِي إِلْتَزَمَهَا. So she would leave all that worship which she adopted. فَيَكُونُ رُجُوعًا عَمَّا بَذَلًا لِرَبِّهِ مِنْ نَفْسِهِ. So she will go back from that which, she will go back from that which she, strive to present in front of her Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is not good. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told her not to do this. And then he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not grow weary of rewarding you until you become, well, that's the meaning of the hadith. Yani Allah doesn't become weary, i.e. Allah will not stop rewarding you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not leave you without reward. حتى تملو, until such a time where you become weary, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Meaning what? Meaning when you become weary and tired of ibadah, and you stop doing the ibadah therefore, and you don't have the same mahabbah and the same focus and khushu in your ibadah because of your tiredness and your weariness. When you have this, then your reward will decrease and your reward will stop if you stop. But if you maintain it, Allah will maintain His giving of reward to you. Hence, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the next part, كَانَ أَحَبُّ الدِّينِ إِلَيْهِ مَا دَاوَمَ صَاحِبُهُ عَلَيْهِ. The most beloved of deen, the most beloved type of deen, the most beloved iman to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? مَا دَاوَمَ صَاحِبُهُ عَلَيْهِ. It is that which the possessor of that continues on and persists on and does not leave, he said sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So this is what is beloved to Allah. بِدَوَامِ الْقَلِيلِ تَسْتَمِرُّ الطَّاعَةِ بِالذِّكْرِ وَالْمُرَاقَبَ وَالْإِخْلَاصِ وَالْإِقْبَالِ عَلَى اللَّهِ. If a person, Imam Nawawi mentions, rahimahullah, when a person does a small amount of ibadah, whatever they are able to do, they are able to continue that remembrance, and they are able to do it with muraqaba, with ikhlas, with iqbal ala Allah. Yani if it's a small amount which they can manage, they are able to maintain focus, they are able to maintain a sense of watchfulness from Allah, sincerity, and focus, tawajjuh upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بخلاف الكثير الشاق حتى ينمو القليل الدائم بحيث يزيد على الكثير المنقطع أضعافا كثيرة. He says, as opposed to a lot of ibadah which becomes difficult on you, such that a small amount which is continuous will grow in its reward until it will increase and go far beyond the reward of that large amount of ibadah which you do once and then you stop. So a continuous small amount will grow and increase in its reward far beyond that which you do, that which is large in amount, but then you stop because you become tired of it. This is why we should choose in our life that action and those good deeds which are small, but we can maintain in our lifetime. And this is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we, for example, outside the five prayers are necessary, we can't choose. I can't say, I'm praying three prayers out of the five and that's iqtisad for me. No, you must perform all five of them. So all five prayers, but outside of the five salawat, making dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tilawa of the Quran, sadaqah in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or and the rest of actions of good that we have been instructed to do, we've been through so many of them in the previous chapter. All of these actions of good that we do, choose whatever you can from them, which you are able to do, and you are able to maintain, even if it's little. This is what he is telling us, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if it's little. If it's dhikr, if you can only do 100 istighfar a day, do 100 istighfar a day, don't leave it. That will be great in reward for you. If you can only perform two nafil extra daily, for example, as salatul awwabin after maghrib, or as salatul tahajjud, for example, then choose two, maintain that too, and don't go beyond that unless you are able to, and that will be enough for you. If you are only able to give £10 a month in sadaqah, choose that and maintain that, and that will be enough for you, he said. So choose whatever amount is small but continuous, and this is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ibn al-Jawzi rahmatullahi alayhi explains the beauty. He explains the secret behind why Allah loves the small and the continuous. Why does Allah love small actions which are continuous? The Imam explains, he says, لِأَنَّ مُدَاوِمُ الْخَيْرِ مُلَازِمٌ لِلْخِدْمَةِ. Because a person who is consistent on actions of good, they are constantly in the khidmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَيْسَ مَنْ لَازَمَ وَقْتًا فِي كُلِّ يَوْمٍ كَمَنْ لَازَمَ يَوْمًا وَانْقَطَعَ شَهْرًا. The one who chooses a portion of time every day and serves daily is far better than the one who serves for one day and then stops for a month. Service of a daily service, which is small in its amount, is far more beloved than service which is done for 2 days and then stopped for a month. And this is why, this is the secret behind why Allah loves small deeds which are continuous. Why? Because it means you are constantly in the khidmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, though it is small. And Allah loves those who are in His khidmah constantly, though it is small, rather than those who do His khidmah once and then they don't do it again for 2 months or 3 months. So this is this is the secret why Allah loves small continuous actions. وَلِأَنَّهُ بِتَرْكِهِ الْعَمَلِ بَعْدَ دُخُولِهِ فِيهِ كَانَ كَالْمُعْرِضِ بَعْضَ الْوَصْلِ فَهُوَ مُعْتَرِضٌ فَهُوَ مُتَعَرِّضٌ لِلذَّمِ. The Imam mentions also, once you enter into an action, and then you turn away from that action, it's like a person who's reached their destination and then they turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that such a person is blameworthy because they have presented themselves in the court of Allah by doing that good action. But when it's too difficult for them to do and they turn away, now they have moved away from that destination, they are deserved of blame from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So go to Allah with those actions which are small and consistent and which you can manage. And Allah Ta'ala loves this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves this. Rather than going in there, diving into the deep end, and then realizing you can't do it, and then turning away from the door of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not beloved to Allah. So that's why Allah loves the small and consistent actions. We come to the next hadith. Hadith number 143. We finish on this hadith, and this is a very beautiful hadith, which shows us the essence of moderation in our deen. Hadith number 143, inshallah. Final hadith of the day.
وعن أنس رضي الله عنه قال قال ثلاثة راهطين إلى بيوت أزواج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يسألون عن عبادة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فلما أخبروا كأنهم تقالوها فقالوا أين نحن من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقد غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه وما تأخر. قال أحدهم أما أنا فأصلي الليل أبدا. وقال الآخر وأنا أصوم الدهر ولا أفطر. ولا الآخر وأنا أعتزل النساء فلا أتزوج أبدا. فجاء رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إليهم فقال أأنتم الذين قلتم كذا وكذا أما والله إني لأخشاكم لله وأتقاكم له لكني أصوم وأفطر وأصلي وأرقد فأتزوج النساء فمن رغب عن سنتي فليس مني متفق عليه.
الله أكبر.
And I said, three people came to the house of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to ask about how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam worshipped. When they were told, it was as if they thought it was little, and said, where are we in relation to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who has been forgiven his past and future wrong actions? He said, one of them said, I will pray all of every night. Another said, I will fast all the time and not break the fast. The other said, I will withdraw from women and never marry. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to them and said, are you the ones who said such and such? By Allah, I am the one among you with the most fear and awareness of Allah. But I fast and I break the fast. I pray and I steed and I marry women. Whoever disdains my sunnah is not with me.
Allahu Akbar. This is a beautiful hadith, very beautiful hadith. So, three men came to the household of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who were these three men? Number one, Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu an. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, who we've already heard from earlier today. And number three, Sayyidina Uthman ibn Mad'un radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And they were incredibly zealous and passionate in their ibadah and their desire to attain the qurb of Allah. Hence, they asked about the worship of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, when they were informed about it, they believed it was little, i.e. little in relation to them. Not that they thought the Prophet was not doing enough, ma'adallah, but little in relation to them. And they said, وَأَيْنَ نَحْنُ مِنَ النَّبِيِّ صلى الله عليه وسلم وَقَدْ غَفَرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَبِّهُ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Where are we from the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, when Allah Ta'ala, yani when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has no sins at all. He has no mistake, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no sins to be pardoned from Allah. Where are we from him? I.e. he's doing this amount and he's got no bad deeds, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's protected and preserved from ma'soom, from all bad deeds, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where are we from him? I.e. we are weak in our ibadah. We in relation to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we make mistakes. We therefore require more. And so, filled with this passion, what did they say? One of them said, I'm going to pray all night forever. I'm not going to sleep. And then the other one, I'm going to fast forever. I'm never going, every day I will fast. Every day I will not stop fasting. And then another one, I will leave women and I will never marry. I will never marry. So this is their passion. We want to attain, you know, a great rank. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's doing this, and he is without sin, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore, we are required to do more. So this is the thought that overcame in their mind. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then went to them and addressed them. How did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam know what they had said? The Imam mentions يَحْتَمِلُ أَنَّهُ أُوحَى لَهُ بِمَا قَالُوهُ. He's وَلَمْ يُعْلِمْهُ بِهِ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْبَشَرِ فَأُخْبِرَ بِهِ مُعْجِزَةً. The Prophet ﷺ was inspired by Allah that people are saying this amongst your followers, O Messenger of Allah. Nobody informed him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired him that people are saying this amongst your followers. Go and tell them. So the Prophet ﷺ went. He said, you are the ones who are saying this. He said, إِنِّي لَأَخْشَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ وَأَتْقَاكُمْ لَهُ. I.e. He said, I am the most fearing of Allah amongst you. And I am the most muttaqi, I have the most taqwa of Allah from amongst you. Yani, جَمَعَ اللَّهُ مِنْ عِلْمِ الْيَقِينِ مَعَ الْمَعْرِفَةِ الْقَلْبِيَّةِ وَاسْتِحْدَارِ الْعَظَمَةِ الْإِلَهِيَّةِ مَا لَمْ يَجْتَمِ لِأَحَدٍ سِوَاهُ. Allah Ta'ala gathered in the heart of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that yaqeen, that ma'rifa, awareness of Allah, that istihdar, that presence of mind of the magnificence, and that presence of mind of the jalal and grand status of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala granted that in the heart of the Rasul, and that was not given to any of the rest of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani that maqam of khashya and khawf of Allah and awareness of Allah that Rasulullah possessed was not granted to any other of his creations subhanahu wa ta'ala. He possessed this maqam sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. What is khashya? When he said, لَأَخْشَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ. Yani, I have the most khashya of you of Allah. What is this? Khashya is khawfun maqroonun bima'rifah. Khashya is that fear. It's fear, but it's not just fear. It's fear which is accompanied, because it is fear which is accompanied with awareness. And it's not fear out of the unknown. That's khawf. Khawf is when you're afraid of something which is unknown. Khashya is because of your awareness of this thing, you are fearful of it. So you are aware of the harms, or you are aware of the the grand status of this, so you are fearful of it. That's khashya. And the Prophet ﷺ had kamalul khashya, the greatest level of khashya. Why? Because his ma'rifah of Allah was the greatest. So the khashya is in accordance with the ma'rifah. So his awareness of Allah was the greatest out of all of the creation. Therefore his khashya, his fear of Allah, was the greatest out of all of the creation. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. And what did he say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, despite my maqam with Allah, despite my status with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, despite that, what do I do? He said, ana usalli layla, he said, usalli wa arqud. He says, I prayed and I sleep, I rest. Asum wa aftir. He said, I fast and I don't fast. As we know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the Quran, nisfahu ya ayyuhal muzammil qum al-layla illa qalila, nisfahu aw inqus minhu qalila. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commanded by Allah to stand for less than half of the night, i.e. the last third of the night. That was what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commanded to stop, to do the qiyam for, just the last third of the night. So that's the ibadah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the night. And aside from that, he would rest. Asum wa aftir. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would fast, we know, on Mondays. He would fast Thursdays. He would fast the 12th, 13th, the 13th, 14th, and 15th, sorry, of each every of every Islamic note, the ayyamul bid, the white nights. He would fast those days sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he would, and in other times of the year, but not every day. He would eat sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَأَتَزَوَّجُ النِّسَاءِ. And we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married. He married numerous times. And so he is demonstrating his sunnah. Then he said, فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّةِ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. This is my practice. I.e. my practice is not monasticism. لَا رَحْبَانِيَةَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. There is no monasticism in Islam. My practice is not extreme hunger and extreme tiredness and torture of the body and the soul and lack of companionship. Humans need companion. Is not, that is not my sunnah. My sunnah is all of, it is a balance between the two. فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّةِ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. So whoever moves away from my sunnah is not from me, he says. صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ. So then for us, as to take as a guideline, is the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to worship and to rest. And rest doesn't mean rest from your fara'id. No. Fara'id have to be fulfilled. Rest means yani worship your nawafil extra, and also don't forget to give the body rest. And also fast some days, eat some days, and to marry. This is also from the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq inshallah to have iqtisad in our deen and our iman, and to hold fast to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. With that, we finish today's session. Are there any questions, inshallah? Okay, barakallahu feekum. We continue from hadith number 144 in the next lesson. Fatiha for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and for his ummah, for relief from all calamities and from all difficulties. And inshallah, we break for Salatul Maghrib. Al-Fatiha, alhamdulillah. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.